All right, if you have been here for the last couple of weeks, we've been in this series called First Fruits. If you've got a Bible today, you can turn to Proverbs chapter 3. That's where we've been the last several weeks. And if you don't have a Bible, as always, we don't want you to feel awkward about that. That's why we put it here on the screen. But if you don't even own one, we would love to give you one as our gift to you. They're out in the lobby at the Next Steps area. But in this verse of two verses in Proverbs chapter 3, we've been talking about how to honor God with our wealth. And I understand, you know, and I say this every time I talk about money, we talk about this every year because we want people to understand when it comes to money, it matters what we do with it. And the Bible talks a lot about this subject. And so we tried to approach this subject on wealth, not just from a standpoint of, you know, God wants us to give, but in the standpoint of we want to help you learn how to be good stewards of your finances. That's why we brought Joe Sengel in a couple weeks ago, and he spoke. If you guys were here, he did an unbelievable job, probably the funniest message I've ever heard on this subject. And then we had the financial learning experience that Sunday afternoon, and several hundred people came to that. And then we have the Rev study that's a six-week study course on how to be good stewards of our money based upon Joe's book, I Was Broke, Now I'm Not, which is, you know, pretty self-explanatory title, right? It tells you what it's all about. And that's what we want for us, to be good stewards. And today's message really is kind of building upon that even more so, because when it comes to this subject, not only does God command us to honor him with it, but he commands with a promise. But before we get into that promise, I want you to understand why this matters. When Joe spoke a few weeks ago, he talked about his story of giving was a love story. And at first when he said that, I was sitting in the 8 o'clock service. I was like, man, that's kind of strange. I never thought, you know, about it quite like that. But then he explained it, because when you love someone, you give. That is what happens, right? And those of us that are parents, we understand this. We love our kids, and therefore we give to them. And I read a study not too long ago that said, on average, a parent spends $250,000 per child. $250,000 per child from birth until they leave your house. That's a lot of money, isn't it? Not very many people cheering for that one. In fact, maybe some of you just newly got married. We're like, we want four kids. That just got reduced down to two, right? You're like, $500,000's all I got, man. That's more than my house. And so kids cost a lot of money. But we give to our kids because we love them. And I came across this quote a while back, and I should have shared it with you last week, but I wanted to share it with you this week that explains this phenomenon. It's from the guy who wrote the play Les Mis, Victor Hugo. And this is what he says. I've got it here on the screen. It says, you can give without loving. You can give without loving, but you can never love without giving. You can give without loving. I can give you $5. I don't have to love you. But if I love you, I will give. This is why, as a father, it doesn't pain me to give to my kids. Now, when they're spoiled brats, I threaten to take that away, right? But I don't have to wonder every day if I'm going to feed my kids. I just have to wonder what I'm going to feed my kids, but not if. I don't have to wonder whether or not they get to sleep in my house. I don't have to wonder whether or not I'm going to clothe them, whether or not we're going to pay for their school, whether or not we're going to pay for their school lunches, for their school uniforms. My goodness, everything that requires them to go to school. Why? Because I love my kids. It's never a question of if I'm going to give to my kids, because I love my kids. And when you love someone, giving naturally follows. And that same truth applies with God. One of the most popular verses in the Bible is John 3:16 that says, for God so loved the world, he what? He gave. See, God built it in this way, that when you love, you give. But what he gave wasn't monetary, it was his son. And so when we think about loving, that's what I want us to think about giving. And when we think about giving, I want us to think about loving. Because the greatest commandment, Jesus said in Matthew 22, is to love the Lord your God. And when you love him, you will give. So it's a natural part of the relationship. But here's what I love about God. God, as you're going to see here in Proverbs chapter 3, not only commands us to give, because that's a way to show that we love him, but he builds in certain promises. He builds in certain blessings to the commands. God didn't have to do that. God didn't have to build in a blessing. He could just command us to give, and that was it. But God is a good God. The primary metaphor that God uses to describe himself is father. So he's a father who loves his kids. And so he says, when we give because we love him, he will bless us. Now, I told you a story last week, if you were here, out of 1 Samuel chapter 2, of the high priest Eli and his two sons who were priests, but the Bible says they were worthless men because they treated the offering of the Lord with contempt. And we talked about in this service that they ate the offering. Now, I understand last week I talked about eating steak, and you probably all were salivating at the mouth. It's about 11:45, right? You're like, I'm hungry. So forgive me for talking about it just for a little bit again. But when it comes to the offering in that story, they didn't give like what we give today with cash and credit and checks. They had literal livestock and produce. And so they would give out of that. And so they would give a cow, and then they took that offering, and the first part of that was to go to the Lord, but Eli and his sons were eating it first. So they were literally taking their fork, 1 Samuel 2 says, sticking it in there, getting the filet mignon and sticking it in their mouth. They were eating the offering. But here's the principle, and I'm gonna show it to you in Proverbs chapter 3, but I'm gonna give you the point first, and then I'm gonna show it to you in scripture. So here's the first point. If we eat the offering, then we swallow the blessing. If we eat the offering, instead of giving it to God, if we eat it, then that just became the blessing. The blessing that we could have gotten by giving it, we just swallowed it, no blessing. So when we think about this as a principle of honoring God with our wealth, I want us to understand something that God built into the principle, a natural blessing if we will obey him. Now let me show you that in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 and 10. So let's go to the scriptures and you judge whether or not I'm right, all right? I'll just go ahead and tell you I am. But you judge, all right? How you like that? Proverbs 3, verse 9 and 10. Just being funny, if you're new here, I'm really not that arrogant, all right? Proverbs 3, 9 and 10. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of all your produce. That's what we talked about last week. Honor God. That's weight. Put weight behind our words. That's what our wealth is. Now look at verse 10. Then your barns will be filled with plenty. Your vats will be bursting with wine. Then. Everybody say then. That was pretty good. Say it again. Say then. Then. That's a conditional statement, which means verse 10 is conditional upon the actions of verse 9. But here's what I want to point out to you. Hebrew word order of a sentence, because this was originally written in Hebrew, is different than English. And a lot of times Hebrew word order doesn't matter. They put things in different orders than what we do in English, because English word order does matter. But a lot of times Hebrew order doesn't matter. But sometimes it does. And I think this verse is one of those times. You know, English reads from left to right. Hebrew reads from right to left. And in this verse, in verse 10, it literally reads in the Hebrew, then will be filled your barns with plenty. So the then is not connected to the phrase your barns, it's connected to the phrase will be filled. Then will be filled. Now this is why this is important. This verb here, because it's a verb, will be filled, is what's called a reflexive verb. A reflexive action. Here's what I mean by that. It's conditional upon a previous action. Anybody here taking physics, you know that we know that every action has an equal and opposite what? Reaction. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. That's why when you shoot a gun and it fires off this way, it's going to recoil back this way. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. It's just true. throughout all physics. This is why when I was in my physics class, I've never forgotten this illustration. My physics teacher said, if you're an astronaut in space and you're floating away and you got a wrench in your hand, he said, instead of trying to throw the wrench at the ship to get their attention, throw it away from the ship and then you'll float back to it. I'm like, oh, I've never forgotten about that. I was like, that'll never happen, but I get what you're saying. Because every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Where does that come from? Where do the laws of nature come from? God. God built it this way. And this is one of those laws. And here's what he's saying. He's saying, when you honor God, action, there is an equal and opposite reaction of filling. You honor God, and with that action comes the action of your barns being filled. They are connected. They are inseparably linked. And the reason why God is saying this is because he wants us to understand something. He wants us to understand that we don't have to be so consumed with trying to fill up our own barns. We can't think like most people do, hey, God, I will fill up my barns, and then if I have any left over, I will honor you. That's not a reflective action. That doesn't always happen, does it? More often than not, no. But God's saying, hey, if you honor me, if you put me first, then I will fill your barns. It is inseparably linked. It will happen. It's called a promise. And so the point is this. God is saying, when we honor him first, he has built into the system an equal and opposite reaction that you will benefit from. That's how good God is. So when we honor him, the principle is he will fill our barns. So let's, two things I want to break down from here. Two things, and I've got these down as points, two principles that I take out of this verse. Number one, and we hit this last week, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it, honor God. When it comes to your wealth, honor God. Now, I've given you three P words there because I like alliteration. It's easier to remember. When I talk about honoring God, I want you to have three ideas in your head. Number one, priority. Priority, that means put him first, right? We have quoted the great theologian, Ricky Bobby, if you ain't first, you're what? Last. So priority. Do you know when the word priority came into the English language, it was singular? We changed it to plural, and we now say priorities. But do you realize if you have priorities, then that means you don't have priority? That's a contradicting statement. I got my priorities out of whack. No, you got your priority out of whack. It's singular. So God needs to be first. This is what Jesus said in Matthew 6. Seek me and all these will be added to you. So God is first. Second one there, percentage. Honor God by percentage. Now this is the biblical concept of tithe. Now before you shoot me, because I know some people say, Pastor, we're in the New Testament, the tithe is not New Testament. You probably don't say it like that. And if you believe that, please, I'm not trying to make fun of you. But here's my thing. And I did this when we did the Ten Commandments. Any Old Testament law or principle, Jesus ups in the new. He doesn't diminish. So people who say, I don't believe in tithing, you know what I always say to them? Oh, you do more than 10. High five, baby. That's what I call spirit-led giving. Spirit-led is going to be honoring God, and it's not going to be less than what he commanded before. So if you don't like the concept of tithing, fine. Just give by percentage. And that percentage, I say, because the Bible says 10% is the floor, not the ceiling. The goal is not to get to 10 and stop. The goal is to get to 10 and blow right through it. And I don't say this arrogantly, but Lindsay and I give more than 10. And one of the primary reasons why is, did you know that there were multiple tithes in the Old Testament? There wasn't just one 10% tithe. Most theologians and scholars believe that the Israelites gave up to 22% of their income. There was two tithes, two 10% tithes, and then there was offerings on top of that. And they have calculated it up to be about 22%. One of my heroes in the faith is a pastor by the name of Rick Warren. He is a reverse tither. He gives 90 and lives on 10. So honor God, percentage. Which leads to the third one, progressive. The goal is not just to get to 10, the goal is to blow right past it. That was what I was just saying. The goal is to build on it every year. I never forget, I heard Rick Warren say that him and his wife decided when they got married, they started at 10, and then every year they just increased it by 1%. And they did that until they got to 90. And amazingly, God blessed him. And he wrote the second best-selling book ever next to the Bible. You trust God and watch what he does. You honor him and watch what he does. Which leads to my second principle. Number one, honor God. Number two, have barns. Have barns. Now, this may seem like childish to you, but I have just come to understand that a lot of times the simplest explanation is the right one. Now, I don't know how many of you have a barn on your property. Some of you may have one, but barns today aren't what they were before. When people had barns, it's because they went and got all their crops, which was all their wealth, and they brought it into their barn. So it was their storehouse. And most people that I know today that have barns, they're not storing their wealth in there. They're storing their junk in there, right? So don't think physical barn, and I've given you some examples here. When I say have barns, this is what I mean. A savings account, IRAs, which is just individual retirement accounts, investments, real estate. There's all kinds of ways to have barns. So two financial principles out of this verse. Very simple. Honor God, have barns. Now here's why I'm saying this. I've met a lot of Christians over the years that honored God with their wealth, but they were bad stewards of their wealth. They didn't have wisdom. And I'm not trying to be mean, but I want you to hear me. Faith is never a reason to make dumb choices with your money. I'm just having faith that Apple stock's going to rise. I think a lot of times we guise things with faith that a wise person would say is dumb. Like I call that, you know, one example, missionary dating. He's not a Christian, but I'm a missionary to him. Well, that's great, but the Bible says that's stupid. You don't need faith to date a non-Christian. Hello? Do you hear me? McFly? Faith is never a reason to not have wisdom. They are not mutually exclusive, friends. We are called to have both. The faith part comes in saying, I'm going to give to God first. That's the faith part. Then we're called to be good stewards with the rest of it. That's the wisdom part. And here's what I'm saying to you. This is a principle that I did not understand, especially when I was younger. I did not have barns. I did not have storehouses. That's literally what the word translates. Storehouses where money is stored. I lived like most people live, paycheck to paycheck. I'll never forget getting paid in high school and in college. And I would take my check, and a lot of times I would go to those check cashing places that they charge me 8% to get my money. You know what I mean? And I would give to God first, but I'm not kidding. I would take the rest of that paycheck and I would go straight to the mall. And I would blow that paycheck on clothes. Or I would go straight to the audio place and buy all kinds of audio equipment for my vehicle. I'm telling you, man, I had some junky cars, but some unbelievable sound systems. My very first car was an 82 Ford Bronco, four-wheel drive. I loved it. And it had an unbelievable system in it. JL Audio, man, it was good. My whole back seat was taken up in my sound system. Amps everywhere. Just thinking about it, man. I mean, whew, that was nice. But here's the thing. I ain't got that system anymore. You know why? Because that system was a bad investment. The only return I was going to get from that system was deafness. I wouldn't get any return from it. I didn't have a savings account. And Lindsay jokes with me, when Lindsay and I first got married, I would go to the ATM to check my account balance. I didn't know what was outstanding. And then I would finally get a bill. I'm like, what is NSF? I did not order that for $25. If you don't know what NSF means, that means non-sufficient funds. I mean, NSF and I were friends. Because I didn't know how to manage my money well. But let me tell you another story. True story. My first cousin, my mom's sister's daughter, she's about 4 or 5 years younger than me. She lived not very far from us. In fact, they lived with us for a while when I was younger. She was a saver. That girl saved everything. I'm talking like every birthday party we ever had, there was cash in there. That cash went into her savings account. She would literally walk around her neighborhood and find pennies on the street corners and take all those to the bank and cash them and deposit that into her account. We used to make fun of her, believe it or not, until I got older and realized how wise she was. First cousin, and this is a true story, she saved. You want to know how much she had in her savings account when she graduated college? $30,000. And this was in 2000. 30 grand. And she's a college student. This whole idea that college students have to be broke, you understand, is an American fallacy. They want you broke. Why?
Credit cards.
And I'll never forget, Lindsay and I have been married for a little bit. And Jenica called me on the phone one day. She was like my little sister. Her older brother, my other first cousin, had died his senior year in high school. It was the very first funeral I ever did. And so I was just naturally kind of that big brother in her life. And she called me. She had already graduated college. She had a job. She was a teacher. She had already bought her first house. And she had paid cash for her car. 25 years old. And she called me one day, just really struggling. She said, Jason, you know, I love God, I love Jesus, but, you know, I want to be married. And this is a girl who had never dated a boy. Never. Because I had told her not to, and I had threatened the boys. So she calls me, she says, I'm just really struggling. I want to be married. And I said, Jenica, hold up, time out. I'll never forget, because Lindsay and I were driving somewhere in Pennsylvania because I was looking at starting a church in the Northeast. It was before Revolution. And I said, girl, listen to me. You love Jesus. You're beautiful. She's gorgeous. You have a job. You own a house. And you got 30 grand. Baby, you're going to be fine. Please don't think that you are somehow not in a good place. And lo and behold, about a year later, a great godly guy came in and I performed their wedding. Now, can you imagine that? I was explaining to her, I'm just gonna let you in on a little secret. Any guy who marries you hit the stinking jackpot. Not just because you got 30 grand, but because you love Jesus, you've done it all right. I said, I would have killed to have been married and have all that in order to. Because when Lindsay and I got married, I had a good sound system. Now, I think my cuz made better decisions than I did. You know why? She had a barn, called a savings account. She even had CDs, if you know what those are. Not like the kind that I had in my car with the sound system. College student. College students, do not buy into the myth that you gotta be broke and way in debt. You can be wise. How many of you here, let me just straw poll. You can raise your hand if you feel like it. How many of you here would like to go back to your 25-year-old self or your 15-year-old self and punch you in the face? Look around. Okay. Yeah, me too. I had my first kid at 25. Oh, how I wish I would have had invested differently. And when I'm saying investing, I'm not just talking stock market. I'm talking about savings accounts, retirement accounts, understanding how money worked. And so when I'm saying honor God, I'm not saying honor God to the point where you're a bad steward. No, honor God and have barns. Here's why. Because God promised to fill them, but how can he fill a barn you don't have? How can he fill a barn you don't have? So if you'll open up a savings account, if you'll open up some retirement accounts, if you haven't already, I know a lot of you probably already have, and you get out of debt, and you honor God, and you have barns, then watch God do what God does. But if you eat the offering, you swallow the blessing. So it's pretty simple. Honor him, have barns. Now, I know this feels a little bit more like a seminar, and I don't want it to, so let's get back to preaching, even though that is preaching. Go back to Proverbs chapter 3. Let's go back to the scriptures here, and I want to back up a little bit to verse 5. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, very famous verse, but I want you to understand context. And I say this to you often. Anytime you read a scripture in the Bible, you have to read the context around it to understand what it's saying. Now, Proverbs is a little bit different because Proverbs is not a narrative. It's not a story. It's just collections of sayings that were written down by King Solomon. But sometimes there is context. There is several things he's saying that all kind of connect together. And chapter 3 is one of those instances. So I want you to see the connection between verse 5 and verse 9 and 10. Listen to what he says in Proverbs 3, verse 5. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. Normally when I put a scripture on the screen like that, you see the yellow kind of bolded part? I do that to point out something I'm going to emphasize, but in this verse, I just pretty much said the whole thing except for the word and, because it's so good. And I want to break this down for you. When it says trust in the Lord, that word trust means to put hope or confidence in. Here's what the connection I want you to see to verse 9. When verse 9 says honor the Lord, you honor him because you first trust him. You think he is trustworthy. So if there's some of you here that are not honoring God with your wealth, I want you to understand something. The reason why you're not honoring him is because you do not trust him. Because if you trusted him, you would honor him. Your belief drives your action. And so if you have an action that is sinful or wrong, you have to attack not just the action, but the belief underneath that action that is motivating it. And the belief underneath the action of honor is trust. Trust. So honoring God is really a trust issue. What you do with your wealth is really a trust issue. But you can't say that you trust God and not honor him. Because if you honor him, it proves that you trust him. But here's the key. He says it, and it's almost like the Bible understands us. He says, trust the Lord and lean not, or do not lean on your own understanding. Here's the problem with my decisions. I think all my decisions are right. Right? I can justify all my decisions, even the wrong ones. I can have some kind of excuse and do my best to help you understand why I made the decision I did. Why? Because I'm normally right in my own eyes. That's the problem. So the problem with my relationships is not me. It's her. It's him. It's you. Why? Because I'm right in my own mind, according to my own understanding. But here's what you need to see. Your own understanding and trusting God are mutually exclusive. Those two cannot live together. And God never calls us to understand him. God only calls us to honor him. And this is why a lot of people say, well, once I understand God, then I'll honor him. But that's not how this works. Because do you think that you can understand an uncreated God in this 6 inches of gray matter? I mean, like, is God that small that he's limited to your capacity to understand him? Now, some of you are wicked smart, like crazy smart, crazy IQs, and you're too smart for God. But what I would say to you is he's a little bit bigger than that. So we're going to have to come to the end of our own understanding. Listen, you know what? I know it doesn't make sense to give to God first and to give to God percentage and to give to God progressively. A lot of financial advisors will tell you to back that off a little bit. But they don't understand the power of the promise of God. You honor him first. And it's not always going to make sense, friends. But if you trust him, that's what you'll do. And then he says this, in all of your ways, acknowledge him. Now, does that say in some of your ways? That's like me saying to my wife, hey, baby, some of the places we go tonight, I'm going to acknowledge you. You're my baby. I'm going to put my arm around you. But some of the places I'm not going to acknowledge you. I'm going to stay over here, take my ring off. You can just stay over there. Any wife going to go on that date? No. It's not because she's vain or selfish and she wants to be acknowledged everywhere, but it's a matter of love. God's saying, no, in all your ways acknowledge me. And here's the promise. And I will make straight your paths. This is the best news of the good news of the gospel. God can take crooked people and straighten them out. That's the good news, friends. God can take your messed up circumstance, your messed up life, and you honor him, and he will straighten it out. I love how Martin Luther said it, the founder of the Protestant Reformation. He said it like this. I've got it here on the screen. God can draw a straight line with a crooked stick. God can draw a straight line with a crooked stick. I'm not standing before you today because I am, you know, this amazing man. I'm standing before you today because I was a crooked man who God is still straightening out. And what I'm saying to you is it really comes down to trust. It really comes down to honoring God. And when you do that, he has made the promise that he will straighten out your circumstances. You can trust him. But go to verse 7 and 8. Go to verse 7 and 8. This builds on verse 5 and 6. Be not wise in your own eyes. Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones. Can I just say something to you with you not taking it offensively? If you're broke and all your friends are broke, you need new friends. I'm not saying you need to do away necessarily with those friends. You just need to get some new friends that ain't broke. Because if you're broke and you go to your broke friends and you say, hey, should I buy this? Their first response is, I don't know, can you afford it? Which is the wrong question. If you go to a friend that's not broke, they will say to you, I don't know, is it wise? See the difference? Broke friends say, man, finance that sucker. Can you afford the payments? I don't know why I always talk like that when I'm talking. It's a default, I guess. I think it's because I'm so redneck. Like, that is just where I go. That is what I think. If you ask yourself, can I afford it? And you look at your budget, and you're like, well, I got $500 in there. How much the payment? $499. Sweet. Bam. It's like free money. 3% interest. Wrong question. Is it wise? Is it wise? Is this a wise investment? Is this a wise strategy? Be not wise in your own eyes. Get wisdom at all cost, Proverbs says. I can't tell you, I mean, I have told you some, how many bad mistakes I have made when it comes to our finances, because I'm the spender. And I've had to really work hard of saying, you know what? Just because I can afford it doesn't mean I should. Is it wise? And then he says this, fear not. Fear not, I mean, not fear not, sorry. He says, fear. Fear the Lord. Which that phrase there, fear the Lord, literally means to worship him, to give him respect. It's not fear in the sense of like you walk into a dark room, someone's gonna jump out at you. It's fear in the sense of saying respect, honor him, and turn away from evil. What I'm saying to you is what we do with our money can be evil. That's what happened to Eli and his sons. They were worthless. Why? Because of what they did with the offering. And what I'm saying to you is honoring God is part of it, and then having barns and wisdom is the other part of it. That's what it means to turn away from evil. Turning away is the idea of repentance, of saying, I'm not doing that anymore. I'm going to do something different. And I think a lot of people have tried to faith their way out of bad circumstances as if that was an excuse to not have wisdom. So honor God and get wisdom. That's why we had the classes that we have. You can buy Joe Sengel's book, I Was Broke, Now I'm Not. Anything by Dave Ramsey is fantastic. But all that principle comes from here. Get wisdom at all costs. But let's be straight. Why do most of us not do this? I mean, think about this. I want you to really think about this. If God says, you honor me and you have barns, I will fill it. And then he says, your vats will be overflowing. That's a wine press, which means when you go to press that out, it will be overflowing with new wine. So you honor me, you have barns, and I will multiply. Why do we not do this? It sounds so simple. It sounds so prophetic. It sounds so amazing. God said, this will happen. Do you know why we don't do it? Because it's hard, right? Please do not hear me saying, oh man, it's so easy to honor God and have barns. No, because hunting season comes around and you want that new crossbow? You want that new boat? You want that new purse? You want that new car? I get it. I live in the same world, people. I do not live in a cave behind the church. It's hard. But if you don't want to, if you wish you could go back and punch your 25-year-old self, if you make a decision today, then your 45-year-old self won't want to come back today and punch you. Or your 55-year-old self, or your 65-year-old self. It's hard, but it's worth it. Let me leave you with one last quote. I told you I had a lot of quotes today, but I love this one by one of my favorite authors, Dr. Henry Cloud. He said this, that which is good for you is hard at first and easier later. That which hurts you is easier at first and becomes way harder later. You do the hard thing now of honoring God and having barns, and it will get easier. That is the promise. Let's pray. God, thank you for your grace in our life. I thank you for the power of the promise of your word. And today's message, God, is not about something we want from somebody. It's something we want for them. God, because I wish somebody would have set me down early in my 20s and grilled this into my head. I don't know if I would have listened, but at least I would have known. But God, I do thank you that you have shown me this in your word, and you have brought wise people around me. And God, I pray for everybody in this room or watching online, because in a room like this, there are people here that are honoring you. They are putting you first, percentage, progressing in it, and they do have barns. And so God, I just pray that you give them the faith to keep doing that. I understand in economies like this that those barns aren't growing quite as much as we want, but let them have the faith to keep doing the right thing. But God, I also know in a room like this that there are people that maybe are honoring you, maybe they have been giving to you, but they don't have any barns to speak of. They don't have any storehouses where wealth is being accumulated. And so God, I pray that you would put it on their hearts to have the tenacity to figure this out, to go buy a book, to go get a mentor, to get an advisor, and create some barns and keep honoring you and then watch you fill them. But God, I know in a room like this, there are people that are not honoring you. And God, the message today is not one to just try to make them feel bad about what they're not doing. The message today is one of hope. It's one of promise that says, if we will honor you and we will have barns, then you will bless us now and in the life to come. So God, I pray equally for that person who's not honoring you. I pray that they would understand that in the end, they are only harming themselves. So help us in faith to honor you and help us in wisdom to have barns. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.